So difficult. Becoming over Tag is so difficult. You hear me constantly complaining. But without you, you know, I wouldn't have any... I wouldn't get angry. Ah. So, thanks to all of you, I can get angry. But angry is not really the right word. Annoyed. No, more always something stronger. Yeah, without you, I would be all in peace, huh? Not then, Alex, huh? So, Dennis, and Dennis, are you looking forward? Not really. It's a good training, huh? You don't take it serious enough. You say, for you, it's a job, huh? It's more a job than a training, isn't it? It's a duty that you have to do. Yeah, I mean that's how our Westerners see it. Yeah, it's a duty that we have to do. You know, and you like to get it over with. Yeah. Huh? What do you think? What do you think, Ten Richard? It's a duty that we like to get over with, to get to our own playground. Huh? Any disagreement? So, nobody disagrees. Everybody agrees. It's not a duty, it's a training ground. Yeah? Think about the war elephant, yeah? The training of a war elephant, yeah? Yeah? You remember? Yeah? All these bears, you know, who put into the skin of a war elephant, yeah? Training. Yeah? And the war elephant is not allowed to react. Yeah? So there's only one week left to Pavarana. I mean, Tan Dennis, Tan Amata, Tan Benny, Sankang Pante Pavare Mi. You know it? You better know it. So, it's our first, nearly our first panzer here. What do you think? Shall we go back to Bandhat? It doesn't seem, you know, that this place, you know, I mean, really fosters your practice. You have too much leisure time. Yeah? Bandhat, you have too many duties you do. Yeah? It keeps you probably more alert. Huh? You can sleep the whole day. There's hardly anything to do. So you use the time wisely, yeah? The last week, you use it, yeah? To foster sati, panya, the weapons that we need to fight the kilesas. Sati is knowingness, is the awareness of what is going on in our heart. Everything, from every intention, from every sense impression, no matter hearing the wind at the moment, or the thunder, and we know the reaction when we are at the level of the heart, we know the reaction if there is a reaction in the heart, yeah, towards the sense impression, towards a thought, towards a feeling. That's when we have sati. That's when we are aware of what is going on within our heart. And that's the only place that we are looking. Lungda often said, Yamong Konin, Mong Duay. Don't look at others, what others are doing, look at yourself, what you are doing. But it's probably because of our upbringing in the West that we constantly look, you know, at the faults of the others and we don't see what we are doing, we don't see our own faults. So it is a little bit more difficult, you know, to look just at ourselves, yeah? And see what is going on, because we might not like it, what is going on within our heart. We see all this turbulence, we don't like it, that's why we look outside. Yeah? Then we get distracted from the turbulence that is running on in our heart. Yeah? This constant this constant restlessness or boredom or, you know, what do I do now, what do I do now? Yeah. What is there? How can I get rid of it? Yeah? Because that is what is going on in our heart all the time. What am I going tomorrow? You know, how was it yesterday? Or thinking about the past that we do remember. That's why we like to distract ourselves with what is going on around us. Yeah? But that is not what the teaching is about. Yeah? The teaching is about to know what is going on within our heart. Yeah? Every kind of sense impression that comes in, every feeling that arises, every thought that arises, every memory that arises, and the reaction of the heart towards this memory or towards this feeling or towards the sense impression. Yeah? I mean, we have to slow down. Yeah? We really have to slow down. I mean, that's what we're trying to do when we do meditation. Yeah? The calm meditation. We slow down the mind so that it doesn't constantly think and brings up or shows all the things that are going on in our heart. And in the beginning there will be a negative reaction towards this. And as I just said, I mean, we don't like to see what is going on in our heart. Especially the kilesas don't like to see, to let us see what is going on. Because that's their home. That's their basis. That's their field of war. And they don't want anybody to intrude. That's why it's so difficult for us to look at that place. Look at the heart. At the level of the heart, you can also say at the level of the citta, that's where the things are happening, that's where the things evolve. Here, in the present moment, there is only one present moment. When this present moment passes away, the next moment comes. We are aware of the breath, we are aware of our Buddha. We can be aware of the Buddha with breathing in and Buddha with breathing out. We constantly focus only inside. And it doesn't mean that we don't notice the wind. You don't notice the sound of the wind or the sound of the rain or the sound of the thunder, but we are not interested. And we also don't try, to get rid of it. Neither do we want to get rid of it, nor do we invite it to come. Whatever is there in the heart, however the heart reacts to it, that's what we want to see. That's what we want to look at. That's what we want to know. But primarily when we focus on our samadhi, we want to know how the breath is or how the Buddha is. And we don't put our attention on the other things. And it could be so calm. There's nothing anymore in the heart, it's completely calm. It's empty. And the emptiness of the heart reveals the rise of birth and death. No matter if it is the birth of the body or the death of the body, it's a birth of a feeling, it's a death of a feeling. If you slow down enough, you see everything arising and ceasing. We purely, slowly concentrate in on our citta. And just see this arising and ceasing. And there's no reaction to it. Towards it. There is just this constant sense impressions that are going on. And the sense impressions come if you want them or if you don't want them. They will come, they will stay on for a while, and they will disappear. It's so, would be so easy, just to sit there and observe. Observe the breath while knowing about all these sense impressions that come into our heart. And if you don't focus on these sense impressions, heart gets calm and calm and calm. Until it gets completely quiet. Until there's nothing left in the heart anymore. No reactions towards anything. And that is the peacefulness, or that is the happiness or contentedness that we are longing for. And it all happens within the heart. Doesn't happen any place else. It doesn't happen with good food or coffee or whatever. Just happens here, the contentedness, the complete contentedness happens here within the heart. All what we need to do is to look, to observe. And not to follow the thoughts that lead us outwards, or the reactions that lead us outwards. It could be so beautiful if you were just able not to give in to this constantly dragging of the kilesas us into anything, be it thoughts, be it actions. But once we enter samadhi, the kilesas are outside. We close them out, we are in the safe house. And they cannot attack us there. They are there, we see them in the beginning, we still see them waiting, impatiently waiting, making signs, to look at them, to notice them. But if you don't give attention to them, you get calm and calm and calm. And the mind gets so concentrated that it doesn't even want to think a thought. Doesn't want to think Buddha anymore because it is too much work. And that's where you see, how much mental work you constantly do. Once you get into the calm, you see it, and you think, oh, it's so bothersome to think all these things. But that's not the stage that you are at, You still think, this thought is nice to think, this memory is nice to keep. You're still deluded by these kilesas that make you believe that this thought is important to think, that this memory is important to think about. Or to ask the question, why are these things coming in? As I told very often, this question is not the question that we should ask. Why? The question that we normally should ask, what happened? What came before it happened? To understand the process. We need to understand the process that this citta is working. If you don't understand the process, or if you don't understand the way or the methods the kilesas use to track us out, there's no cure. And that's why we need the sati. We need the ability to observe what is going in our heart, every reaction. And if it's already over, then we ask, what happened? Just what happened? Not why, what happened? Now you can also ask yourself, if you want to get more interested, what the hell is going on? How could I react the way that I reacted? What was going on before the reaction took place? What kind of thoughts? What came before these thoughts? What kind of feeling? What came before these feelings? What kind of sense impression? What came before the sense impression? Until we come, until we roll it all back, if we don't find, to the moment we woke up. What happened then, when I woke up? I feel so sick. And then, what came then? And then we believed it. Because we really believe that we are the body. If the body is sick, then it is sick. But the citta is not sick. The citta has nothing to do with this body. It is the driver. If the car breaks down, that doesn't mean that the person who drives the car cannot walk or cannot talk or cannot think. It just means that he cannot drive the car comfortably. But if you want to go from here to there, then of course also the driver might get annoyed, or sad or whatever it is. We are not this body. Really get to know it, that we are not this body. We are the driver, the citta is the driver of the body, and the citta and the body are two different things. But you constantly lament over this body. I'm so tired. You tell it yourself, I'm so tired. I can't concentrate anymore. Who is this I? Get down to it, find it somewhere. Where is this I? Constantly falling for the illusion, I. Achilles says, tell us, that we are them. And if we are them, we can't fight them. We can't eliminate it. We can't crush them. We can't find their hideout. And we can't find their methods. If we believe what they suggest. And they constantly suggest, it's me, it's mine. I'm in a bad mood. I'm so sad. I'm full of doubts. There's nothing that we can do. Because we believe we are the kilesas. How can you fight the kilesas if you believe? You can't fight yourself. You can only fight the kilesas that are the imposters and make us believe that we are them. You get the idea? They tell us it's fine. They tell us it's not fine. They tell us, all the time. Even when we sit down to meditation, they tell us you have to do it like this. No, you have to do it like that. Oh, that is not good. Oh, that would be better. Why don't you try it this way? Are you not sick of this constant regiment of the kilesas? Constantly tell you what to do, constantly correct you, constantly want to change this, constantly want to change that, They're never satisfied. Until we leave them in front of the door and we go into the safe house. Then we see we are not them. Because we are contented, we are constantly contented as long as we are in the safe house. And there is no I in the safe house. There is no ego. So the Kilesas, in order for us not to enter into the safe house, the Kilesas, produce some fear. If you go there, I'm lost, I die. Good. Whatever can die, it shall die. Yeah? Whatever is left over should be left over. And then we see just this clear knowingness that is left over. This whole universe can disappear if you even go further. Yeah? Go deeper into samadhi until we reach apana samadhi or the deep state of samadhi, then this whole world, yeah? There is no more sense impression, there is no more thoughts. Yeah? Thoughts have disappeared long time ago. Yeah? There's no more sense impression, and the body, slowly disappears from our senses, yeah? Or the senses disappear. You can take it either way. And then there's nothing. Well, except for our real nature, for our true nature. Yeah? This knowingness, this clear, sharp knowingness that does not know any object. Because if it knows any objects, then it's still in duality and it is not in deep samadhi yet. So the knowingness itself for itself, yeah? And it is difficult to describe because, our language always deals with duality, with good or bad, yeah? Or black and white. So how can you describe something that is beyond this duality? And that is where we go when we go into apana samadhi, when everything disappears. There's just this knowingness. No? And that is only in retrospect when you come out of it that you can say, oh, all what there was, was knowingness. Yeah? You can't tell very much about it. Then you go back in upacharya, there's this whole universe, yeah? Upacharya is access samadhi, you have access to all these realms, yeah, if you want to, if you have the ability to do it. You can go into the ghost realms, you could go in the deva realms, you can go into the hell realms, huh? If you have the ability, if you can read the signs, where to go and how to proceed. But that is not important, yeah. Important is in the upacharya samadhi that at least, yeah, without too much effort, we can get into a stage where we are contented, where we can recharge our batteries. Yeah? And that is important. To recharge the batteries or to sharpen our knife, yeah, that we need. Yeah, the sharper our knife is, the easier it is to cut down or to kill off the kilesa. Yeah? This here, yeah, just like the place of Lumta Mahabodha, is the forest university. Yeah? The forest university differs, from any kind of school, from high school, yeah, from primary school, secondary school. Yeah? In a school, you have this class or that class, yeah? And after this class you have math, you stop, yeah? And chat with your friends, and then you go into next class, you forgot what happened in the first class. Yeah? That's cool. The forest university of meditation is you don't stop. You open your eyes, and then you start your practice, yeah? Until you close your eyes. Yeah? It is very, very, very important. So, listen. Listen very clearly. When we do formal practice, no matter if it is walking meditation, sitting meditation, we just don't stop sitting meditation or just don't stop walking meditation, we just change our posture. Yeah? We don't relax the mind and say, okay, now you can think. Yeah? Because then, if we do this kind of practice, right? Just like in class, yeah? We stop and then think about something else, and then we go into the next class, and yeah? And then after that we stop and think about something else. We will not progress on the path. We have to have a constant sati, From the moment we wake up, yeah, and I don't understand. You read it before, you know, in the book of Lung Dama Bo, yeah, or in the talks that are translated. It describes it, yeah. There's no time where you can relax your attention, your sati. It's not, I did 3 hours of walking meditation, now I can think about this or that. Or now I can do this, you know, and we completely forget our sati. And that seems to be the case here. When I look at you, it seems to be the case that you really, very hard, you know, I mean, you try very hard, you know, 1 hour or 2 hours or 3 hours of meditation, yeah, and afterwards you relax your mind and let all the kilesas take the energy away, yeah. So in the next class you have to start afresh. That's why you don't build up energy, that's why you don't build up sati, and the sati is gone very quickly, yeah. You do that, and you just waste your energy, yeah. And then after three years or 4 years or 5 years, you ask, my practice is not going anywhere. How can it go anywhere if you constantly let your mind loose? Yeah. I mean, if you want to train a dog, yeah, and tell it, you know, to go here or do this or do that, you know, not to go here and not to go that, yeah. And you give it free time in between, you know, your lessons, yeah. This dog will not learn. You have to constantly train it. In order to know it cannot do this, it cannot do that. But if you let it go, if you let it run for half an hour here or there, you know, and don't observe it, what happens? This dog will not learn. Just like our mind, just like our heart will not learn. You cannot let it go. That's a forest university. We learn. The moment we wake up, you know, we know what thought is on our mind, we know what memory is on our mind, or we know what dream is on our mind, and then we install the Buddha or we install our sati on the breath. And then we keep the sati, or we try to keep this sati, no matter if we do formal practice or not formal practice. Yeah? If we don't do any practice, yeah, we keep our sati on the breath, or we keep our sati on the Buddha. That's it. That is the training here. And I really wish, you know, that you comply with it. Yeah? And that is very tough. Yeah, I mean, you read the talks. Yeah, I mean, Dhamma that comes from the heart, and you know it, yeah? I mean, Lung Dhamma Habo said it, yeah? I mean, it was like hell. It did not let the mind go out, yeah? No matter what he was doing, no matter if he was eating, no matter if he was sweeping, no matter if he was washing his clothes, yeah? He did not let the mind go out. He always pulled it back to Buddha. And that's why he was successful. And you are not successful because you don't do it. You let the mind, you know, you give it a break, give me a break, give me a break, yeah? The kilesa is constantly asking, give me a break, let me do something, yeah? Let me do this, let me do that, yeah? And that's why your practice is not becoming stable, yeah? If you ever wondered why your practice is not stable, you know, it's because of this. So if you really want to progress, you know, I mean, then you have to get a stable practice first, yeah? So I hope you listen very well, yeah? And don't forget it. Practice is all day long. There is no time for a break, yeah? I mean, we practice, you know, not only 5 days a day, yeah? 5 days a week, yeah? We don't practice, you know, a day, you know, 7 or 8 hours. If you constantly practice, yeah? No matter if it is formal practice, yeah? Formal practice is easier, it does get us deeper. Yeah? if you don't do formal practice, then we practice at least sati with whatever we are doing. Yeah? Be it sweeping, be it eating, be it arms round, yeah? Pindapa, yeah? Or be it, you know, being at the panna place, yeah? Afternoon tea. Be it washing, yeah? Washing your clothes or washing your body. Constantly, yeah? don't relax. Yeah? Otherwise, and that's probably the reason why your practice doesn't progress anyway. Yeah? Otherwise your sati will not, you know, build up, yeah? It's like a person, you know, I mean who works very hard, yeah? I mean, earns a lot of money, yeah? I mean, the moment, you know, he stops working, you know, he spends the money, yeah? And then he has to work hard, you know? And then in the end, you know, I mean, after years, he asks, why don't I have any money? Huh? Because in the meantime, huh, between working hours, you know, I mean, he spends the money that he earned so hard. So how can he get rich? How can we get rich in Dhamma? If we constantly, you know, let our mind walk around, yeah? Trample on us, yeah? Bringing up this idea, bringing up that idea. How can we progress? Remember this very well, yeah? It is one of the keys of the practice here, yeah? How to practice. It's a key to how to practice, yeah? From the morning till the evening. There is no gap, there is no break. Yeah? 7 days a week, yeah? All year round. There is no way, there is no time for how I'm relaxing. Yeah? Because the moment you start to relax, I mean you lose all this work, all this money that you have earned so hard, all this sati that you have earned so hard, the moment you relax, you lose it. So we better don't do it. So that is how we practice. Yeah? What we practice is, first of all, you know, sati. Yeah? Sati, getting the mind calm, getting it contented. I talked, you know, often about it, yeah? I mean, by now you should know how to practice sati, how you practice, yeah? Buddha meditation, or how to practice keeping attention on the breath, yeah? Knowing that the breath goes in, knowing that the breath goes out, yeah? Knowing that the Buddha is fast, knowing that the Buddha is slow. Yeah? I talked so often about it. That's the second. The third is, yeah? I mean, developing panya. And I mentioned it before, we are not the body. Yeah? You constantly think, I'm the body, I'm tired, yeah? I'm hot, I'm cold. Yeah? I'm sad, I'm depressed, I'm in doubt. Yeah? I mean, you can't work in this way. That's not a mode, yeah, where you can develop panya. Yeah? You always have to say, there's a feeling. Put them in front of you. There's a feeling of sadness. There's sickness. Yeah? There's well-being or there's not well-being. Yeah? There's a sense impression. There's hearing, not saying I hear. Yeah? There's tasting, not saying I taste. Yeah? That's how you differentiate from the thing, you know, or try to separate out, yeah, the citta from the body, the citta from the senses, the citta from the feelings, from all the khandhas, from rupa, vedana, sanya, sankara, vinyana. Yeah. You can all observe them. It's all possible to observe these five khandhas, so how can you be the khandhas? Huh? How can you be any of these khandhas? But then, the moment you know you take ownership of these khandhas, I mean, then you're in big trouble. Yeah? It's my memory. It's my thought. It's my feeling. Yeah? It's my body. Then you're in trouble. I mean, and your prok and your panya will not develop. Your wisdom will not develop in this way. So try to separate it out. It is a long task. It's not. It won't get easy. Yeah? You will fall into trap very often. Yeah? In the beginning, most of the time. Yeah? Until you train it. Ah. Yeah? The moment it comes up, the thought comes up. I'm sad. Ah. Red alarm lamp. No, there is sadness. Ah. Okay, let's look at it. There is restlessness. Now let's look at it. There is disinterest. Now let's look at it. There is boredom. Now let's look at it. Yeah. There is pain. Ah, wonderful. Now I have a stable object. Yeah? What is pain? Investigating pain. Or investigating this body. What is this body? It's a construct. Yeah. Take it apart, put it together. Take it apart, put it together. Yeah? Until you clearly see the separation taking place. Yeah, that the citta doesn't see anything. Sees the body in front of it and knows that it's not the body. This realization has to come. Otherwise, you will constantly feel, or you will constantly think you are the body. And then when the body is weak, you feel weak. When the body is healthy, you will feel strong. Yeah, and so on and so on. No, you have to, you really have to get it down. You really, I mean, and that's the same thing. Mm. Not only once a day. When you see it coming up, instantly you react and say, no, there's a feeling. No, there's a memory. No, there's a thought. Yeah? You have to train this. It's a long, long training. Yeah? And I can't promise you how long it takes. Yeah? It depends on your effort. It depends on your determination. Yeah? If you put a lot of determination and effort in it, you know, I mean, it won't take very long. If you constantly get despaired, you know, instead of saying, ah, there's despair, let's have a look at it. What does it look like? What does it feel like? Yeah? What came before the despair and what comes after it? Yeah? Then it won't take long. Then it will take a long time. Yeah? So use this principle. I mean, all what I was talking about in the last few minutes, you know, is the principle of anatta. That's not me, that's not myself, that doesn't belong to me. Whatever I can see, whatever I can feel, whatever I can hear, whatever I can think, whatever I can memorize. Eh? There's nothing to do with me. Yeah? These five khandhas are not me, are not mine. Yeah? But we need to use them. Yeah? We need to use memory, we need to use thoughts to ask the right questions. And to remember exactly what we were doing, you know, 2 minutes ago, yeah? In our recollection at the end of the day, or during the midday, or whatever, yeah? Whenever it is convenient for you. This recollection is the first step, you know, towards developing panya. Knowing what one has been doing, knowing what one... What kind of thoughts came in? What kind of memories came in? What kind of reactions took place in the heart? Yeah? And what, knowing and understanding what caused these reactions? I mean, it's essential. We have to understand this machinery that we are living in. Yeah? And in order to understand this machinery, I mean, we first have to separate ourselves out. Yeah? We are not this, we are not this computer. Yeah? But that seems so difficult because you like the idea that you are this computer. Yeah, but if you like this idea, then you will die. Yeah, together with this computer, and then suddenly wake up in a new body, yeah? Or die within this robot, or die in the car. Yeah, and the next moment you think about it, you wake up in another car. Maybe it's not so comfortable anymore because it belongs to the ghost realm or to the hell realm. Think about it very clearly. Yeah? And I just want to stress it again. Yeah? The importance is how to practice here in this monastery. The moment you open your eyes, you have sati, until you close your eyes in the night. Yeah? No matter if you do formal practice, and you don't let the mind go. Yeah? Don't let it take a break. Yeah? It constantly asks, the kilesas constantly ask for take a break. Ah, I practice so hard, you know. Huh? Let's have a break. Yeah? I mean a mental break. I don't mean a physical break. I mean you can go to the toilet, yeah? Or you can drink something. That is a different kind of break. Or you can do walking meditation. But you should not relax the attention. You should not relax sati. Yeah? Is that understood? Is that clear? During the day you should not relax sati, the attention on the heart, what is going on in the heart. No matter if you do formal practice or not. Yeah? Of course, with formal practice it's much easier to keep the attention on the heart. Yeah? When you're busy with something like sweeping, you know, or washing, or yeah, then it is much more difficult. But that's where our training lies. Yeah? So, you understand that? It is clear now? Yeah? Because otherwise, if you don't follow this recipe, if you don't practice like this, yeah, I mean, you can practice the whole life, and you can practice very hard. Yeah? But every day you spend the money that you so hardly earn. Yeah? So, earn so hard. Yeah? Understood? Please remember that what I was talking about today. Yeah? It is very, very important. Yeah? Okay, then I close the talk. But it's not easy. I mean, I've never said it's easy. This kind of effort, you know, I mean, we can sit for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, you know, and then have a break, you know, and sit for another 3 hours, yeah. And that's what we are used to, you know, especially when we come from meditation centers, yeah. That's how they do practice in meditation centers. And in the evening they have their free time, yeah, their leisure time. I mean, that's how we don't progress, you know, we are here at the university, yeah? And that it is difficult, it is really difficult, yeah, to constantly keep sati, to constantly be aware of what is going on within one's heart, yeah? It's difficult, it's very difficult, yeah? But if you can do it, it's a lot of joy, yeah? Then you start to live in the real world, yeah? Not in your imaginary world, yeah? And then you don't use anymore your khandhas for Xbox entertainment or whatever it's called, yeah? PlayStation entertainment, yeah? It's not a PlayStation, yeah? We need this tool, yeah? We need these five khandhas in order to get liberated from the kilesas, yeah? The five khandhas are not the kilesas, yeah? The five khandhas are five khandhas, yeah? We can use them to work, yeah? To undermine the power of the kilesas, and the kilesas can use them or normally use them for their own entertainment. Yeah? Okay, clear.